Hello everyone, welcome back to the course of software engineering. This video is brought to you by Newton's group of institutions in association with Redefined Solutions. This is Arvind Egireddy from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering. And in this video, we will discuss about software engineering practice, a generic view. Now let us see what is software engineering knowledge. Many software practitioners think of software engineering knowledge almost exclusively as the knowledge of specific technologies like Java, Perl, HTML, C++, Linux, Windows NT, and so on. Knowledge of specific technology details is necessary to perform the computer programming. If someone assigns us to write a program in C++, we have to know something about C++ to get our program to work. We often hear people say that the software development knowledge has a 3-year half-life. Half of what we need to know today will be outdated within the 3 years. So in the domain of technology, related knowledge, that is probably about right, but there is another kind of software development knowledge, a kind that I think of as software engineering principles that does not have a 3-year half-life. These software engineering principles are likely to serve a professional knowledge throughout his or her career. This was been stated by Steve McNone. So here, the intent of this video is to present the concepts and the principles that serve as a foundation for software engineering practice. The concepts and the principles presented in this video are applicable regardless of the specific process that is used, methods are chosen, or tools that are applied. In many cases, the concepts and the principles discussed here in this video should be revisited as each software engineering activity is presented during the course. Now coming to software engineering practice, here practice is a broad array of concepts, principles, methods, and tools that we must consider as a software is planned and developed. So it represents the details, the technical considerations of how to's that are below the surface of the software process. The things that we will need to actually build high quality computer software. So in this video, we list the generic framework, communication, planning, modeling, construction, and deployment, and umbrella, tracking, risk management, reviews, measurement, configuration management, reusability management, or work product creation, and the product activities found in all software process models. George Polley, in his book written in 1945, he describes the essence of software engineering practice as understanding the problem, both communication and analysis. That is, who are the stakeholders? What are the unknowns, data functions that the features to solve the problem, and can the problem be compartmentalized or can the problem be represented graphically? And according to him, we need to plan a solution. We need to model the software design. Here, we have to ask questions, have we seen a similar problem before? Has a similar problem been solved? If so, is the solution reusable? Can the subproblems be defined? Can we represent a solution in the manner that leads to the effective implementation? So these are the questions that need to be asked at the stage of planning. Then once after the planning is completed, we need to carry out the plan. So here, does the solution conform to the plan? Is each component part of the solution probably correct? That is what we need to ask ourselves. then we need to examine the results for the accuracy. That is, we need to test and we need to see that the quality is correct. So we need to give the quality assurance. So is it possible to test each component part of the solution? And does the solution produce the results that conform to the data, functions, features, and believe that what is required, that what we have achieved? So here we need to see that the software practice is a broad array of principles, concepts, methods, and tools that we must consider as software is planned and developed. So in the software process, we provide everything with a roadmap for getting to a successful destination. And practices provide us with the details we need to drive along the road, where the bridges, the roadblocks, and the forks are located. So it instructs us how to drive, where to slow down, where to speed up. So in the software engineering context, it is what we are, what we do in a day-to-day out as software evolves from an idea to a reality. So here three elements, principles, concepts, and methods. And the fourth element, namely tools, support the applications of methods. That is what we are going to discuss in this particular video. So here, in this chapter, we discuss about the core principles, principles of software process, principles of software practices. Then we discuss about the principles of each activity, principles of communication, principles of planning, principles of modeling, both requirement principles and design principles, and principles of construction, coding principles, and testing principles, and principles for deployment. Now coming to the first one, that is principles to guide the process. That is principles that guide the process. So regardless of whether the model is linear or iterative, perspective or agile, it can be characterized using a generic process framework that is applicable for all the process models. So here the following set of core principles can be applied to the framework and by extension to every software process. So here the first principle, be agile. So every aspect of the work we do should emphasize economy of action. Keep our technical approach as simple as possible and make decisions locally whenever possible. Then we need to focus on the quality at every step. So the exit conditions for every process, activity, action, and tasks should focus on the quality of the work product that has been produced. Then we need to be ready to adapt. So when necessary, we need to adapt our approach to constraints imposed by the problem so that the people and the project itself. Then we need to build an effective team. So build a self-organizing team that has a mutual trust and respect. Then we need to establish the mechanism for communication and coordination. So project fails because important information falls into the cracks or stakeholders fail to coordinate their efforts to create a successful end product. So these are the management issues and they must be addressed. Then we need to manage change. So the approach may be either formal or informal, but mechanisms must be established to manage the way these changes are requested, assessed, approved, and implemented. Then we need to assess the risk. So here, a lot of things can be going wrong. So software is being developed. So it is essential that we establish contingency plans. Then the last one, we need to create work products that provide value for others. And we need to create only those work products that provide the value for the other process activities, actions, or tasks. Now coming to the principles that guide the practice. So here the software engineering has a single goal to deliver on time, high quality operational software that contains the functions and features that meet the needs of all the stakeholders. So here the following set of core principles are fundamental to the practice of the software engineering. First one is divide and conquer. Analysis and design should always emphasize the separation of the concerns, SOC. So here a large problem is easier to solve if it is subdivided into a collection of elements or concerns. And ideally, each concern delivers distinct functionalities that can be developed and in some case validation independently from other concerns. Next, we need to understand the use of abstraction. So here, an abstraction is a simplification of some complex element of a system which are used to communicate the meaning of a single phase. So if software engineering practice, we can use many different levels of abstractions. Software team normally begins with models that represent those models that respect high level of abstraction and slowly refines those models into lower level of abstraction. Then we need to strive for consistency. That is whether it's creating a requirement model or developing a software design or while generating a source code or creating test cases. The principle of consistency suggests that the familiar context makes the software easier to use. Example, consider the design for a web app. Consistent placement of menu options, the use of a consistent color schema and the consistent use of recognizable icons all help to make the interface more sound. So here, the next principle is focus on transfer of information. So here, the software is about information transfer from end users into GUI, from an OS to an application, etc. So in every case, there are opportunities for errors or omissions or ambiguity. So here, the implementation of these principles is that where we must pay special attention to analysis, design, construction, and testing of interfaces. So building software that executes effective modularity is the fifth principle. So here, any complex system can be divided into modules, but good software engineering practices demand more modularity and must be effective. That is, each module should focus exclusively on a well-constrained aspect of the system. And additionally, modules should be interconnected in a simple manner. Each module should exhibit low coupling to other modules, to data sources, and to other environmental aspects. And the sixth principle, that is look of patterns. So the goal of patterns within the software community is to create a body of literature to help the software developers resolve recurring problems encountered throughout all the software development. Then, when possible, we need to represent the problems and its solutions from a number of different perspectives so that it will eliminate all possible errors. Then the last eighth one, we need to remember that someone will maintain the software. So over long term, software will be corrected as the defects are uncovered, adapted as its environment changes, and enhanced as software requirements have more capabilities. So these maintenance activities can be facilitated in solid software engineering practice is applied throughout the software process. Now, let us see the principles for each of these activities. Coming to the first one, that is communication principles. Here, the communication principles are practice. Customer requirements should be gathered through the communication. First, we need to listen. Focus on the speaker's word rather than formulating our response to those words, ask for clarification if something is unclear. Then we need to prepare before we communicate. We need to spend time to understand the problem, prepare our agenda for the meeting. Then someone should facilitate the activity. So every communication meeting should have the leader that does it. Keep the conversation moving in a productive direction. We need to solve the conflicts and ensure that other principles are followed. Then there should be a face-to-face communication, which is the best, but it usually works better when some other representations of the relevant information is presented. Then we need to take notes and document decisions. Someone should serve as a recorder and write down all important points and the decisions. Then strive for collaboration. So here the collective knowledge of the members of the team should be combined to describe the product, its functions and its features. Then we need to stay focused, modularize our decisions. So here the facilitator should keep the conversation modular, leaving one topic only after it has been resolved. Then we need to see that if something is unclear, we need to draw a picture. Then once we agree to something, we move on. If we cannot agree to something, we move on. So if a future or the function is unclear and cannot be cleared at the moment, we move on. So here coming to the 10th principle. And the last one is negotiation is not a contest or a game. It works best when both parties win. But still we need to compromise from both. Now coming to the planning principles, we need to understand the scope of the project. Scope provides a destination. It is important to use a roadmap if we do not know where we are going. Then we need to involve the customers in the planning activity. These customers defines the properties and establish the project constraints. Then we need to recognize the planning, whether it is iterative. So the plan must get the changes to accommodate the changes. Then we need to estimate based on what we know. If the information about the efforts, cost, task, duration is unclear or unreliable, estimates will be also unreliable. Then we need to consider the risk as we define the plan. If we have identified the risks that have high impact and high probability, contingency planning is necessary. So we need to be realistic. So when the project plan is established, realities like people do not work 100% on of every day, omissions, ambiguity occurs. So the best software engineering can make mistakes, etc., should be considered. Then we need to adjust the granularity as we define the plan. So it refers to the level of details that is introduced as a project plan is developed. So here, high granularity provides the significant work task details for short term, and low granularity borders the details for long term. Then we need to define how we intend to ensure the quality. If technical reviews are to be conducted, they should be scheduled. So in pair programming is to be used during the construction and it should be defined within the plan. Then we need to describe how we intend to accommodate the changes. So even the best planning can be obviated by uncontrolled change. So we must have plans for customer requests. Then we need to track the plan and make adjustments as required. So the software projects fall behind the schedule one day at a time. Therefore, we need to look at the plan daily. Then coming to the modeling principles. So here, the primary goal of the software team is to build a software, not a model. So model that shows the process down or provide little new insight should be avoided. Then we need to travel light. That is, we do not care more models that we need. So every model that is created must be kept up to date as a changes occur. So more importantly, every model takes time that might otherwise be spent on construction. Therefore, we need to create only those models that make it easier and faster to develop. Then we need to strive to produce the simplest model that will describe the problems of the software. By keeping models simple, the resultant software will also be simple, and the result is a software that is easier to test and easier to maintain. And we need to build models in a way that makes them willing to change. That is, we need to assume that our models will change, but it makes these assumptions did not become sloppy. And we need to be able to state an explicit purpose for each model that is being created. So every time when we create a model, we need to ask ourselves why we are doing so. Then we need to adapt the models we develop to the system at hand. So it may be necessary to adapt the models, notations or rules to the application. Then we need to try to build the model, but forget about building perfect models, because modeling should be conducted within an eye to the next software engineering steps. So which has an iterations endlessly to make the model perfect, but does not serve the needs for the SILT. So don't care, because dogmatic about the syntax of the model, because if the communicated controls is controlled successfully, representation is the secondary. So if a model communication which communicates the information successfully, then incorrect syntax can be forgiven. So if our instinct tells our model is not right, even though it seems okay on the paper, we probably have reason to be considered. So if we are experienced software engineers, we need to trust our instincts. That is, we need to trust our what our mind says. So if something tells us that the design model is doomed to fail, we have reasons to spend additional time examining the model or delivering a different one. So we need to get feedbacks as soon as we can, so that every model should be reviewed by the members of the software team. So here the intent is to provide the feedback that can be used to change the misinterpretations, to correct the modeling mistakes, etc. So if software engineering here in the modeling principles, the software engineering works with two class models. One is requirement models, which are also called as an analysis models. So here they represent the customer requirements by describing the software in three different domains: the information domain, the functional domain, and the behavioral domain. Then we have the second model, that is a design model, which represents the characteristics of the software that helps the partitioners to construct it effectively. So here the architecture, the user interface, and the component level details are noticed. Now coming to the first one, that is the requirement model or analysis models. So here the information domain of a problem must be represented and need to be understood. So it encompasses the data that flows into the system, the data that flows out of the system, and the data that is being stored. Then the functions that the software performs must be defined. So here the functions can be described at any different levels of abstraction, sir, ranging from a general statement or purpose to a detailed description of the processing elements that must be invoked. And third, the behavior of the software must be represented. Here the input are outputs provided by the end users, control data provided by the external systems, or monitoring data collected over the network, all causes the software to behave in a specific way. And fourth one is the models that depict the information, functions, and behavior must be partitioned into a manner that uncovers the details in a layered fashion. So here, a large complex problem is divided into subproblems until each subproblem is relatively easy to understand. That is, we are going to apply divide and conquer technique. And the fifth one is the analysis task should move from essential information towards the implementation details. So here, the essence of the problem is described without any consideration of how a solution will be implemented. Then coming to the design modeling principle, that is the second principle. Here, the design should be traceable to analysis the model. So here, design model translates the information, like information domain of the problem, user visible functions, system behaviors, etc., collectively at the analysis stage into an architecture. Then the second one, we need to always consider the architecture of the system to build. So here the design should start with architectural considerations because it affects the interfaces, data structures, program control flow. Then the design of data is as important as the design of processing functions. And here, interfaces, whether they may be internal or external, must be designed with care. So here, a well-designed interface makes integrations easier and assists the testers in validating the component functions. Then fifth one, user interface design should be turned to the needs of the end user. So no matter how good its internal functions, no matter how comprehensive its data structures, or no matter how well designed its architecture, a poor interface design often leads to the perception that the software is bad. So here the interface design should be tuned to the needs of the end user. If it is not correct, then the software will be bad according to the persistence of the user. Now coming to the sixth one, that the component level design should be functionally independent. Here, the functionality that is delivered by a component should be cohesive. And seventh one, the component should be loosely coupled to one another and the external environment so that to reduce the error propagation and increase the maintainability. Then design representation should be easily understandable. And ninth one, the design should be developed iteratively. With each iteration, the design should strive to get for greater simplicity, like all the activities for the requirements. Now, coming to the construction principles. So here, the construction activity encompasses a set of coding and testing tasks that lead to operational software that is ready for delivery to the customers or to the end users. Here the coding principles and concerns are closely aligned programming style, programming language and programming methods, where the preparation, programming and validation is done. Next, testing principles and concepts lead to the design of tests that systematically uncover the different classes of errors and to do so with a minimum amount of time and effort. Now coming to the preparation principles, here before we write one line of code, be sure that we understand the problem we are trying to solve. We need to understand the basic design principles and concepts. We need to pick a programming language that meets the needs of the software to be built and the environment in which it will operate. We need to select a programming environment that provides tools that will make our work easier. Then we need to create a set of unit tests that will be applied once the components of our code is completed. Then coming to the coding principles, here as we begin writing code, be sure that we constrain our algorithms by following structural programming practices. We need to consider the use of pair programming. We need to select the data structures that will meet the needs of the design. We need to understand the software architecture and create the interfaces that are consistent with it. We need to keep conditional logic as simple as possible. And we need to create the nested loops in a way that makes them easily testable. And we need to select the meaningful variable names and follow other logical coding standards. We write the code that is self-documenting, and we need to create a visual layout that aids the understanding. Now, coming to the validation principles, after we have completed our first coding pass, be sure that we conduct a code walkthrough when appropriate. Perform unit tests and correct the errors we have uncovered and refactor the code. Coming to the testing principles. So here, Al Davis, Dave 95, suggested the following testing principles. So principle one, all tests should be traceable to the customer requirements in addition to the structural tests about the logic. And principle two, tests should be planned long before test begins. So even before any code is generated. Then the pair to principle applies to the software testing. That is 80% of the errors uncovered will be coming from 20% of all programming components. Testing should begin in the small and progress towards the testing in the large. So here the individual components first, then the integrated system. Principle five, exhaustive testing is not possible according to Davis. Now coming to the deployment principle, customer expectations for the software must be managed. Too often the customers expects more than the team has promised to deliver, and disappointment occurs immediately. And the second principle is a complete delivery package should be assembled and tested. A CD or other media containing all software documentation should be assembled. A support resume must be established before the software is delivered. An end user expects responsiveness and accurate information when a question or a problem arises. So there should be a maintenance, and we must see that the problems be solved, rectified, and our technicians give a good support, and we need to take feedbacks as and when required. Then appropriate instructional material must be provided to the end user. So if any problem occurs, then those small problems, instead of always giving a call to the customer care or to the helpline, we should give a manual for troubleshooting with certain guidelines. That is in the form of documents, etc., in the form of CDs. So these supporting documents will help them to solve the problems by themselves without always approaching to the customer care or for the technician. Then buggy software should fix it first, deliver later. So we do not send software with some bugs and say those will be fixed in the next release. They never forget it. So we should not sell the software until all the bugs are being fixed. So once when we see that there is no problem and our particular application software is working properly, then only we need to release it into the market. That is, then only we need to deploy. This is the basic principles. Five principles that what we need to follow when we are deploying the product into the market. That's all for now. Thank you. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon for the latest notifications.